Jumping back into a game 10 years later to have nothing really diminish within its experience really is a testament to great characters and level design. Batman Arkham Asylum was released in August of 2009 and made by Rocksteady Studios and published by Eidos and Warner Bros. Interactive. I bought this game shortly after launch and like most people, it instantly became a favourite, and it left me eagerly awaiting more of the franchise and the genre. It was the first time I think I properly clicked with the genre too, and that's because it's a little bit more than your average beat-em-up. It's a mashup between a beat-em-up that also has simple stealth mechanics and gadget-based puzzles. It also didn't have really an over-the-top story and it's confined to one location. It keeps things relatively neat, narrative-wise also. I generally don't do well with open world games, but the thing about this game is that it gives the illusion of an open world, whilst actually in fact being a hub world game. 19-year-old me loved this game for its simple yet impactful linear experience. The story of Arkham Asylum is pretty simple. You are returning Joker to the Arkham Asylum, which is an Alcatraz-like prison on an island a few miles away from the city of Gotham. Joker eventually escapes inside the prison and runs the joint for the remainder of the evening. Why he wants to run the prison is left for you to find out. I'm going to leave it there in case you have not played it. It's not that deep, it's not over the top, it's just a fun yet simple story. But the main question of the hour is, how does it hold up? And there's a few different areas here, so I'm going to break it down. Now, first and foremost, graphics. Could I get past the aesthetic and the animations? It's not the be-all and end-all, but it does exist, and it is one of the first things that you do notice. And the first thing I noticed was, for a 10-year-old game, this doesn't look all that bad, so kudos for them for attempting realism and standing the test of time. And considering that you aren't really fighting or doing much for the first 10 minutes apart from walking down this corridor, you can only really be paying attention to the graphics and the animations. And as I mentioned a few seconds ago, it ain't bad. Other than a few character models, they managed to make the prison feel Victorian and Gothic, lived in and dilapidated. I almost forgot that I was playing a 10-year-old game, and everything looks pretty schmick all things considered. Keeping in mind, in 2009, Assassin's Creed 2 came out with animations like this.
Here, have a taste. A little bitter if you ask me. It just seems lacking somehow.
The body animations were motion captured, but the faces on the other hand were unfortunately hand animated, and the faces are probably the weakest part of the animations within this game. You often get these conversation cutscenes where it's two pieces of cardboard talking to each other.
Is it true that Joker escaped?
Unfortunately, yes. But not for long.
And it's somewhat reminiscent of this.
John, I want a divorce.
Divorce.
It's not funny, John, and you know it's been coming for a long time.
One thing I did notice, and it's a little bit weird, is the pose that all the enemies have for the last kill. It's almost like they forgot to add ragdoll effects and natively went into this pose. It's not a gripe, it's just something that I found odd. If anything though, the only thing aesthetically that hasn't really held up well is when you use your explosive gel to blow up a wall. It simply just doesn't look that great. But overall, who cares? Everything else looks fantastic, and still to this day, I love the fact that they gave some thought to the wear and tear of Batman's cape throughout a really tough night. Now let's move on to level design. How does that hold up? Well, jumping back into this game after 10 years, it actually took me a little bit longer for me to warm into things, and that's probably due to the pacing of the introduction and the tutorial-like nature of the opening chapters, but it really does set up the story nicely. Level design in Arkham Asylum is probably the biggest strength and biggest weakness of this game. When it's good, it's really good, like damn good, but when it's bad, it's merely just disappointing, only because you know that they can make these brilliant levels, and they clearly have stuffed up. For the stealth segments, these work reasonably well. We've all played them before. They generally gave you a lot of options and made it considerably easier to knock off the enemies one by one, and now also considering 10 years later that the AI is not natively all that smart, it was fairly easy to take advantage of. These segments still worked pretty well, and the overall stealth design of those sections were well thought out environmentally, but by the end of the game, they were somewhat of a chore, if anything else. The Riddler puzzles, for the most part, required some simple platforming or some 13-year-old skill set problem solving using your gadgets. They weren't difficult or required much thought, and I never really found myself invested in these 10 years ago, and I found myself not caring about it now either. It's probably due to the reward of collecting these things is fairly minimal. The main strong point of the level design within Arkham Asylum was, in fact, the boss battles and the build-up towards them, often exercising beat-em-up combat mixed with strategic combination with your gadgets. No two bosses were the same, aside from the finale and the B-grade fights in between. You have some really fantastic boss segments, with Scarecrow who puts you in their side-scrolling stealth segment, and these were relatively easy, but still really fun to revisit after all these years. You also have this rather intense section in the sewers in Killer Croc's lair, where you have to move slowly over planks of wood whilst trying to avoid making sound to draw Killer Croc out of the water. Your fight with Bane is more simplified. It relies on the player to use their reflexes and the batarang. And the downside is that Rocksteady recycled the hell out of this fight. They get you to do this fight with Bane over and over again, but instead of being Bane, it's with different enemy NPCs. And really, it ended up downplaying the fight that you have with Bane in the grander scheme of things. Rocksteady has never really said anything about the game being rushed. I mean, the game was a commercial success. I can't imagine why anyone would ever admit that. But honestly, I think the ending is the weakest part of this game in terms of the level design, considering how strong all the other boss battles were leading up to the grand finale. Now, I'm gonna dive into spoiler territory here just for the finale of the game and the boss battle, because I do have some major problems with it. So if you do want to avoid that, just click here, it's okay. Now, the final battle with Joker, it's an actual laugh. Like, it's a bad joke. It pissed me off 10 years ago, and it pissed me off now. I love Arkham Asylum, but it really does feel like it was rushed, or they simply exhausted all creative ideas. But I don't really see how they could have run out of ideas, considering that they made two other games with brilliant boss battles. You walk into Joker's party, and he has two venom-infested goons, and he gets you to fight them the same way you've been doing up until that point. Once that is over, Joker infects himself with the venom, and then he becomes a hulking behemoth. Joker can talk, as opposed to the previous venom-infected enemies who just simply foam at the mouth and they are completely filled with rage with no ability to speak. Joker is the same Joker, he's just a muscly boy. Expecting him to be a similar fight, instead he just walks around kind of doing this drunk man wobble as he tries to hit you, and then he jumps up onto a platform and sends his goons at you. Joker's health bar is comprised of three nodules. You defeat a wave of enemies, you pull him down, and then you instantly punch him, removing one of those nodules. So you do that three times, and then you have essentially completed the final battle and the game itself. It's insulting that this is the final battle we received 10 years ago, and it's disappointing to play now. Going from dodging Bane to sneaking around Scarecrow to fighting waves of enemies whilst avoiding electricity on the floor to trying to be quiet to avoid Killer Croc to performing dodges in a shoot 'em up style battle with Poison Ivy, only to finish up with a completely out of character, uninteresting boss battle, something was up, and my bet is that Rocksteady was rushed towards the ending due to Warner Brothers' time constraints to get this out the door. But honestly, look, it doesn't really ruin my experience. It just more touches on the cliche, it's about the journey than the destination. Okay, so we're spoiler free now, so let's move into the world and character design and how that holds up. Being a comic book based game, Arkham Asylum didn't really have to reinvent the wheel for its characters and lore. Batman had been around for 70 years at the time Arkham Asylum was made, and didn't have to go really looking far for material. Batman is voiced by veteran Kevin Conroy, and Joker is voiced by my hero, Mark Hamill. Both do a brilliant job at reprising their roles in video game form. But all in all, my favourite character of Arkham Asylum was the asylum itself. The island feels like a living and breathing place, and no, I'm not talking about the NPCs running around it. However, the game does this really good job at giving the illusion that NPCs are running around it. Throughout your time in Arkham Asylum, you'll be going from one building to another, and you'll be doing a lot of backtracking in between, revisiting a lot of the same locations over and over again. But not once do those locations end up looking the same than the previous time you were there. Backtracking can generally be considered a bad thing in video games, but Rocksteady have gone ahead and changed that formula somewhat. Now, I'm not going to give it away, as it's something that's really fun to discover on your own, but I'll give you an idea of what I mean. Now take this path for example. In the early stages of the game, this pathway is cut off between paramedics on one side and Joker's goons on the other. As the story develops, the staff of Arkham Asylum are removed or kidnapped, and then it exclusively becomes goons and they become harder, but then it becomes a different type of enemy. And look, the enemies weren't really getting harder, they were just dynamically changing to the plot and within the realm of your gadgets. But hats off to Rocksteady for world building and changing the dynamic of the asylum itself. Mechanically, how does it hold up? Well, the mechanics are fairly simple, and I think it's safe to say that we've heard this comparison a lot over the last few years.
Combat bears a striking resemblance to that from Batman Arkham Asylum.
Taking its cues from the brawling in the Batman Arkham games,
the game riffs on the timing-focused combat popularized by Batman Arkham Asylum.
There's a Batman-like counter system.
Much like in the Batman Arkham games, you can stealthily pick off enemies one at a time, or dive headfirst into a brawl with dozens of opponents and beat the crap out of them with a smoothly animated series of attacks and counters.
Are played out like a third-person brawler with a combat system similar to the Arkham series, but much less refined and definitely much harder.
The combat, which actually reminds me a lot of the Arkham series. Is it as good as Arkham Knight? No.
There's a similar gratification to be had from Spider-Man's combat. The Arkham Asylum-inspired crowd-fighting system suitably characterizes Spidey's acrobatic nature.
Like, it obviously has made a decent footprint to the genre. Throughout your time on the island, Batman collects an arsenal of weapons and gadgets, from batarangs to explosive gels. Gadgets allowed me to hack doors, were easy, but they're fairly annoying, as I never found myself enjoying them. They're just like a little mini-game that involves finding a sweet spot on something, and it's never really a fun mechanic. Even masterpieces like God of War have included these. Mechanics hold up fine, as there was never really anything good or bad that comes out of them to stand the test of time. I think the trick there is keeping all the mechanics fairly simple allowed it to work 10 years on. Has this game done anything to influence the industry and genre? Well, besides the Arkham combat system, which has been constantly referred to, not really, but one could argue that Arkham Asylum has even inspired newer titles for different things.
Who's ready to fly on a zipline? I am!
Grappling.
Trust in the Allfather. Calling upon nature's strength.
I am Blue Thunder!
Anyway, it's probably time that I wrap this up. For a 10-year-old game, it holds up pretty damn well. I managed to play this in a few sittings and found myself really enjoying it throughout my way through. The gameplay is fun, the world was a joy, and the level design was mostly fantastic. The characters were a great time to be around also. It was just wonderful to jump back into the game that has inspired so many others. I finished my time with Arkham Asylum feeling satisfied, but not really eager to play any more like I was back when I was 19. I'm satisfied with the experience that I had, and whilst the ending did leave a weird taste in my mouth, knowing that Arkham City ups the ante, I'm eager to jump into that game in a few years' time on its 10-year anniversary. You can find this game on Steam or on EA Access, or if you have a console, you can pick up Return to Arkham Collection, which has the first three Arkham titles. I'd probably recommend this option, as playing it with a controller is really where Arkham shines. If you like what you've seen here and you want to see more, hit the like and subscribe button. Follow me on Instagram too, under Shawnee Maurice. Thanks for watching.